What is going on, Faith Family Church? Hey, we're so excited about what God's going to do this morning here in this place, man. We're so excited that you're joined us, and we know that God is going to show up huge. Man, do you believe that we serve a supernatural Savior every single day who does supernatural things? I know I'm excited about that. God's going to show up. I want to open up in a word of prayer, and then we're going to get into some worship. Father God, we love you so much. We thank you, Jesus, for who you are, God. We thank you that you're here in this place, God, that you're here in our homes, Lord. God, touch us today, God. Touch us this morning, God, that we can begin to know you in a deeper way, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, we have some special guests leading worship. Let's lean in. Let's get excited. God wants to show up today. Let's go.
Hey friends, it's Cody and Carrie, and we are so excited to be with you in your church today. And I know we're in a crazy time right now where we're all having to isolate and be in our homes, but what I think is amazing is that the church is alive and well.
That's right.
And Jesus is alive, and nothing can stop us. Nothing can stop us, and thank God for technology that we can come together and worship together.
That's right.
In our homes even, which I think is a beautiful thing, that we're meeting with God in our homes all around the world. And so we're just excited to be a part and worship with you today. And you know, there's been so many scriptures that we've really been clinging to in this time, and one specifically for me is Romans 8, just talking about nothing can separate us from the love of God. And in a time like this, I'm so thankful that you can take so many things away from us, but you can't take away the presence of God, the love of God that fills our homes, that fills our hearts, that leads us, that guides us. And so Romans 8 says this: can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity, or are persecuted, or hungry, or destitute, or in danger, or threatened with death? No. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us.
Amen.
And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. That is a good promise that we can cling to today. Jesus is alive, the church is alive and well, and so let's worship Jesus together. I invite you right where you are in your home just to stand up, and let's just sing and worship Jesus together today.
Yes, amen.
Thank you.
sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah.
Be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in, sing it again. And oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. We exalt you, Jesus. Suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west.
Be magnified, the altar.
fire in me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Children, may his presence go before you and be been fearful, you've been questioning, but God, is this really true? Is this really true? And I want to remind you today, yes, it is. And His Word says that everything that He says that He will do, it cannot return void, that it must do what it has set out to do. So we just speak life over you and the promises of God. Just receive them. Just speak it out, even right now. Just say, God, I trust you again. I believe in your promises over my life. I take hold of your promises again and again and again and again. And we tell our souls and our spirit man to line up with the Word of God, to be at peace, to receive the truth of who He is, who He is, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you're here with us, Lord. Thank you, God, for your blood that you spilled for our hearts, God, for our lives, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Can we just take a moment and just reach after him, Lord? We thank you, God. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. You're so worthy. You're so worthy, God, of all of our praise, God, of every single thing that we have, Jesus, of every single moment, of every single second of our lives, God. You're worthy, Jesus, God. Touch us and use us mightily for your kingdom, God, that we can wake up, that we can wake up as the body of Christ and rise up. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, in Jesus' name. Hey, we're so excited at Faith Family. We have this amazing opportunity this morning to give. Who's excited about giving? Two hands. I'm raising two hands. Excited about giving here at Faith Family Church. If we can just refresh ourselves over the five ways to give. We can give in person. You can come by this week. You could drop it off. You can give by text. Text the amount to that number right there you see on your screen. You can give online to faithfamilyag.com/give. You can give by mail to our P.O. box, and you can give on the mobile app. Is there anyone thankful that you can give them in a multitude of ways? It's awesome. So I just want to pray over our offering this morning. Father God, we love you so much. We just decree a blessing for this seed that we're giving back unto the kingdom, Lord. Thank you, God. You love a cheerful giver is what your word says. God, help us to give cheerfully, with a smile on our face, excited about what you're going to do, Lord. Not what we can do, God, but what you can do with this seed that we're planting, God. We thank you, Lord. Use it in a mighty way. We give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody said, I said it, everybody said. It's crazy speaking to a camera, but we're going to make it happen, man. Hey, I'm so excited for this message today, called No Options. I love this. I love this series we're in. I think Pastor Vic killed it. Wherever you're at your house, at a coffee shop, wherever, can you just give Vic just a hand clap, man? Come on, Pastor Vic, man. It was awesome last week. You killed it. And I love you, brother, and it was so awesome. So today we're speaking on living a biblically measured life. Living a biblically measured life. Man, I'm excited and ready, because I know God's going to show up in a huge way. If you could just lean in for about 20 to 30 minutes, I believe God wants to shift our hearts and get us focused on what he has for our lives. Do you know you have a great purpose for your life? Do you know God has a great plan for your life? Do you know you're not a mistake, but God has something amazing set in stone for your life? Man, Father God, use this time. Use this time today, Lord. use these precious moments that we have, God, that we can grow in your name, that we can look more like you, Jesus. That's why we're here. We want to grow in you. We want to look more like you, Jesus. We thank you, God, for these moments. Help us to not take this time for granted, God, but help us to lean into what you have for us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Living a biblically measured life. Now, I believe that the Bible is the most underrated thing that we have. Man, I wonder what it would look like, church, if we would begin to dig into our word, if we began to study who Jesus was on earth, if we began to believe the promises that God has proclaimed over our lives, what would this world begin to look like, church? We're living in a crazy time where people are more scared than ever, where people are more afraid. God is calling us to rise up. And I believe God wants to wake us up this morning to living a biblically measured life. Man, if you miss this whole sermon this morning, if you miss everything I'm about to say, I pray that you hear this. It's time, church, that we begin to live out the calling that God has for us. If you miss everything I'm about to say, I want you to hear this. It's time that we live a biblically measured life. We're not just going to be talking about it, church. The days of just being saved is over, God. We're going to be about it, church. Does anyone believe that? We're going to be about it, living a biblically measured life. Man, I believe, church, that part of my calling is to wake up the believer to this fact that we have to live out the calling. Look, church, I love to preach. I love to preach. It is a calling that God has placed on my life. I love to speak on Jesus. I love to preach. But more importantly than that, but what I love more than that is to see people save, church, to see people, to see miracles happen. And that is because that's what God wants for our hearts. He wants that for our lives, that we need to wake up and live a biblically measured life. Man, church, I want to encourage you to turn in your Bibles really quick to John 1:1. We're gonna share about five verses real quick, and I believe God, these verses are for us this morning. John 1:1, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made." Church, I don't know about you, but when I read the Bible, I get excited, church, because this is crazy. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. Isn't our God great? Isn't our God great? In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcame it. Hold on, y'all missed it. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not and will not overcome it. Church, do you believe that this morning? Man, the Bible is the most underrated thing that we have, church. I want to ask a bold question to anyone watching this morning at Faith Family. Are you digging into your word? Oh, man. I was going to say it's getting quiet, but there's no one in here. So, but are you digging into your word? Are you communing with the Lord? Are you reading the Bible? Are you getting to know more? Are you growing spiritually on your own time? You know, it's not on pastors to grow you spiritually. Oh, man. Man, what are you doing when you're not at church? Church. Are we growing? Are we reading our Bible? Are we getting closer to Jesus? Are we leaning into the promises that he has for us? I love that John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So how important is it to dig into our Word? It's everything that we get to know the promises, and we get to know who Jesus was when he walked on this earth. It's important, guys. It's important. We have to lean in to the word. We must live a biblically measured life. I got 3 points for us real quick. Well, first point, everything in our lives should be governed by the word of God. First point, everything in our lives should be governed by the word of God. It's so important, church. This is so important, church. Every decision that we make must be governed by the word of God. So what does that mean? If you're walking in your day-to-day life and you have to think about, hey, is this okay? Should I be doing this? Should I be Should I be watching this? Should I be should I be doing it? Should I? When you begin to play these games, church, man, we must do everything according to the word. And this is it. We must do everything according to the word. I didn't get saved to play with the sin line, church. I didn't get saved just so I can kind of dip my toe in and out of sin. No, is that what the Bible wants for us? Is that what the Bible says? Man, it says flee from sexual immorality. Oh, he went there. It says flee from sin. That is what the Bible says. Are we living a life according to the word of God? Come on, church, I'm asking. You know, once we start to step away from the Bible, we begin to fail. And this is really important because I've made a plethora, I'm gonna use a big term, a plethora of mistakes. I make mistakes all the time. And those come from not doing things according to the word of God, not doing things for what Jesus has told me to do. And that's when we begin to fail. And that's in every area of our lives, church. That's in every single thing that we do, every single thing that we are. When we begin to stray away from the Bible, when we begin to stray away from what God has called us to do, that is when we begin to fail. And that is in our personal lives. That is in our church as a whole. When we begin to do things out of our own strength, that's when we fail. Once we step away from the Bible, we begin to fail. I've noticed that throughout my whole life. When I begin to do ministry or things out of what I want, it never works. It never works. But when I begin to call upon the Lord and say, Jesus, will you just speak to me in this moment? Will you just give me a fresh revelation for what you have for my life? That's when God begins to move. Come on. That is when God begins to move. So I want to encourage you, whatever season that you're in, whatever that you're dealing with, anything that you're dealing with, call upon Jesus. You can't fight that thing on your own, church. I don't know who that's for. You can't fight that on your own, church. Call upon Jesus. He wants to deliver you today. Come on. He wants to deliver you today through the screen. He's going to deliver you. Amen. Once we step away, we begin to fail. Everything in our lives should be governed by the word of God. Every single thing, every decision you make, every person you meet, are we being the influence, church? When we're at our jobs and all of our jobs are doing things the wrong, are talking and gossiping and cursing and all these things, are you being the influence, church, or are we conforming to what the world wants? Come on. I don't want to be a conformer. The Bible says that I've been set apart. The Bible says I've been set apart when Jesus is with me. Come on. You've been set apart. Be the influence in your workplace. Everything. Not just at church. Not just at church. Not just Sunday morning. Oh, I'm going to praise Sunday morning. I'm going to praise Wednesday night. But when it comes Monday, yeah, I'm going to get back to my old self. Nah, that's not what God's asking us. That's not what he wants. Every single moment, church, governed by the word of God. Dig into your word. Let's get closer to Jesus. Let's get to know who he was on earth. Let's get to know the promises and the names that he's called us. Man, come on. I'm excited. Number two, you've been equipped for everything in your life. It is so important. This is so important because I hear a lot of Christians. I hear a lot of people who say that they're saved. Just like, oh, if I just had that, if I could just get that thing, if I was just in a different place, if our church, all these ifs, but God has equipped you for a great purpose. He's equipped you for a great thing. You've been equipped for everything in your life. I love when Jesus was being tempted by Satan in the wilderness. Does anyone else remember that story? I love that story. You know what the cool thing about Jesus is? Let me just break it down because this is so supernatural to me, that he is fully God and fully man. Isn't that crazy? Do you know Jesus could have just snapped his fingers and Satan disappeared? But he goes, no, I got to teach my people this message. I got to teach them this message that I got to use the word of God to combat these things in my life. Come on. He's trying to teach us something. He was being tempted, and we all know the story of the enemy was like, oh, you're hungry. I know you're hungry, Jesus. Just, hey, those rocks, just turn them into bread, bro. Man, just turn them into bread. I know you like Golden Corral, Jesus. I know those bread rolls are really good. You can turn them into, I'm just playing. You can turn them into bread right now, but no, like, he goes, no, you can't tempt the Lord your God. That's the Bible. That's the Bible. When you're facing something, just begin to quote scripture at the enemy. I'm not even joking, church. I'm not even joking. I wish y'all could see me when I'm tempted. I go crazy. I go crazy because the enemy cannot win in your life. He only takes ground if you give him ground, church. Come on. You've been equipped for everything in your life. Jesus is trying to teach us something, man. Use the word. Use the word. Use the word. The Bible is so valuable, church. It's so valuable. And we take it for granted every single day. We do. We take it for granted. We take all these things that we have for granted. You've been equipped for everything in your life. I don't know about anyone else. That excites me. That, man, I've been equipped for everything. Everything. Man, every night before I went to sleep, my mom, shout out to my mom, was probably watching. Love you so much, Mom. Every night before I would go to sleep, my mom would always tell me, you will do everything God's called you to do. Every single thing. Every single thing, guys. I want to say that and declare that over everyone watching. You're going to do everything God's called you to do. You've been equipped for everything that God has called you to do, church. Every single thing. Come on. We've been equipped for everything in our lives. 2 Timothy 3:15. Love this verse. And how from childhood, I got the Amplified version, so I'm kind of like, go in and out. I really like the Amplified version. But and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings, which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. I love this little surrendering your entire self to him and having absolute confidence. This is so cool. Because here's the thing, church. Here's the thing. We accept Jesus as Savior, but we don't accept him as Lord. I want to encourage you. Maybe that's why you're dealing with what you're dealing with. Have you accepted Jesus as the winning Lord of your life? The reigning Lord of your life is so good. Surrendering our entire self to him and having absolute confidence in his wisdom, power, and goodness. Do you have absolute confidence of who he is? Do you know that when God spoke, things happened? That he's the beginning and the end, the Alpha and Omega? This is all in our Bible. This is all in our word. This is why we got to be digging deep. Because he wants to show up. Oh, have you surrendered everything? All scripture is God-breathed and is profitable for instruction, for conviction, for correction, for training in righteousness, behaving honorably with personal integrity and moral courage, so that the man of God may be complete and proficient, outfitted and thoroughly equipped for every good work. Man, that's so good. That's so good. That's all the things that the Bible is here for. It's God breathed for instruction, conviction, correction. This is why we got to read our word, church. I don't know if you've read your Bible, you just felt convicted, like, oh man, like I got to do better in this area. Oh, I got to get better at this thing. Like, it convicts, it corrects, it trains us in righteousness, man, so that the man of God may be complete and thoroughly equipped for every good work. I don't know about you. I want to be complete in for every good work. I want to be complete for every good work. Every single thing. Every single thing. Our whole purpose. Man. Everything in our lives. We've been equipped. And I always go back to this. But what would our city look like? What would Acworth look like? What would Kennesaw look like? What would Marietta look like? What would Georgia, what would the United States, what would this world look like if we began to believe that, hey, I've been equipped, everywhere I go is holy ground. What does that begin to look like, church? Just dream with me for about 10 seconds. What does your family begin to look like? Man, I'm done complaining about my family. I'm done. It's time for me to step up and go, hey, man, Jesus loves you. I'm going to go be the influence. I'm done complaining about friends. It's time for us to step up, to get into our word, to live a biblically measured life. That is what we're here for today, is to grow in this. We're not going to complain. The world's going to be the world. We got to stop complaining. The world's going to be the world. We have to be the influence. That's what God's called us to do, to step up and be the ones. I love David's spirit, man. He's going to dance until his clothes come off. He's going to be the only one. His own, I believe it was his wife, was like, what are you doing? The person closest to him was shaming him, and he still didn't care. Come on, church. Is there any boldness in this place? I'm going to be the only one. If I'm the only one, so be it. But everyone around me is going to be saved. If that's what it takes, that's what it takes. I'm going to be the one. You've been equipped for everything in your life. There's no more, No, you've been equipped for every single thing, and you will do everything that God has called you to do, church. We're not going to play games no more, church. It's time. We live in a crazy time. People are scared. People are filled with fear. People are lonely. It's time that the church rise up. Man, third and final point. We're going to close it up. And I feel the Holy Spirit in this place, man. I feel people's hearts being changed and never being the same. I pray that that's what this is this morning. Final point. There's no option but to live a biblically measured life. There's no option. I love this series, man. I love this series. Because there's just no option, church. And why do we do it? Do we do it because of obligation? No. We do it because we have this opportunity. Jesus died for our sins so that we can live an eternal life. Man, I don't get to wake up and tell people about Jesus because I have to. No, it's because I get to. Because I love my people. I love people. I love to see people's hearts change. Because I remember when I was over here and didn't believe any of this, and then God sent someone to be that person for me. So what does that look like in your life? There's no option, church. Church, we have to live a biblically measured life. We have to. The biggest thing, this is so important. The biggest thing killing Christians is hypocritical Christians, not the unsaved. It's the hypocritical Christians. It's the people saying, oh, I love Jesus, and then going back to a sinful life. That is what's hurting us, church. That is what it is. And I pray that God convict our hearts. Convict our hearts. Are we living a biblically measured life? I don't want to be the person who raises my hands on Sunday and then goes back to a sinful life. I can't be that. I was that person. It left me empty. It left me depressed. It left me filled with sadness. But it wasn't until I encountered him, church, when I encountered Jesus. Man, thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. I don't know where I would be without Jesus, man. The biggest thing killing Christians is hypocritical Christians, not the unsaved. You know what the awesome thing is, man? Jesus renews, washes our sins with his blood every single day. Isn't that so incredible, church? That even when we make mistakes, God still is there for us. When we were running away, he ran quicker. Come on. I like to think of, I was watching Animal Planet a couple months ago, and it was an antelope, and he was running. He was going quick. Antelopes are quick. And then a cheetah came up and ran quicker. I want to think that I'm that antelope who's like, man, I can run really fast. I'm really quick. I'm going, but Jesus is that cheetah. He's going to come save me. He's going to come after me. He's going to come get me. I want to encourage you, if you're an antelope in here and you're running away from God's purpose, you're running away from God's calling, you're trying to fight temptation on your own, you're trying to deal with all these things on your own, you've been going to everybody else but Jesus with your sins. Come on. I was that person. I was that guy who went to everyone else. Let me go to my pastor. Let me go to my family. Let me go to everything. Let me go to everyone else but Jesus. But it wasn't until I went to Jesus. It wasn't until that cheetah came and got me was when I saw the fulfillment and the freedom that reigns in Jesus. Come on, man. Go after him. There's no other option but to live a biblically measured life. This is the last thing. One story and then we're going to pray and close. But I was talking to a great friend, and man, I met this guy about three years ago, and he wandered into one of our youth services back in my old hometown, and you can just tell he was just depressed, sad. He wasn't talking to anyone. He was sitting in a corner, had his hoodie on, and I just began to start reaching out to him. Hey, man, let's, you know, I'm buying wings. Wings are on me. You know, whatever you want, let's make it happen. Let's do it. So we went to Wings. He came, and we're hanging out, and we just begin to talk about life and just all these other things. Man, he was talking about some video game stuff. Like, I don't really play video games like that, but I'm like, yeah, I'm like entertaining it, you know, just trying to have conversation, build a relationship. Anyway, we began to develop a relationship, and I was like, hey, man, like, we got this thing coming up. It's called Encounter Retreat, man, and I really think that if you would just show up, I believe that your whole life will change. And he's like, he looked at me like I'm crazy, you know, like, just, what are you talking about? Like, what are you, you know, whatever. And I'm like, bro, look, if you would just come up, if you would just show up to this thing, like, it's going to be the greatest thing of your life. So he calls me the day of, and he's like, hey, I just got kicked out of my house, same day. I just got kicked out of my house. My car's broken down, and I'm walking, and he's talking to me on the phone, crying. He's crying on the phone, going, Matthew, I hate life, just all this stuff, man. I'm like, look, I know this sounds crazy. Just Uber from where you're at to this location. I'm gonna pay for it. Just come. I believe God wants to do something crazy, awesome in your life. He ends up doing it, to my surprise. He shows up, and God radically transforms his life. And now he's serving in ministry to this day. But that only came through living a biblically measured life. What does that begin to look like when you begin to live a biblically measured life? When you begin to dig into your word, grow spiritually, look more like Jesus, really live out the calling and purpose that God has for your life. Hey, church, there's no option to this. There's no option to this. That cousin that doesn't know the Lord, he could be that guy that's set to save millions of people, but God has placed you in his life. He's placed you in her life. That neighbor, man, that's doing those drugs right now, God's placed you in her life. This is not I'm going to pray for him. I'm going to come this way. Man, Lord bless him. No, I'm going to run into this thing, and I'm going to go buy their food, love on them, and watch and see how God transforms their life, man. This is what God wants for us, to learn and live a biblically measured life. Have you been digging into your word? Have you been getting closer to Jesus in your alone time? Or are you relying on someone else to do that? No, God has called you to lean in. He's called you to go transform this earth. He's called you to do these things, man. The days of just sitting on the sidelines and praying from a distance. No. I'm in the field. I'm in the game. I said this last time I preached. I played a whole soccer season, didn't play a single game once. There ain't no fun in not playing the game. I'm here practicing 5 days a week. I want to be up in the game. Man, God he's put you in the game. You're in the game. Let's go. Let's lean in and let's live this biblically measured life. Man, everything that we do should be governed by the word of God. You have been equipped for everything in your life, and there's no option but to live this biblically measured life. That's what he's called us to do. That's where we're going. And the gates of hell will not prevail. Not here. Man, I allowed the enemy 17 years of my life. He doesn't get another second in my life, church. Can we rise up? Can we look more like Jesus? Can we dig into our word? Man, I pray that we're not reading our word out of obligation, but we're reading it to learn more of him, to lean closer, to look more like Jesus. That's what I want. I want to look more like him. And I pray that that's all of our hearts this morning, to look more like Jesus, to look more like him. Thank you, Lord. Father God, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you, God. We thank you, Lord, that you're here in this place, that you're moving our hearts, that you're moving by your spirit through these cameras, God, and touching and convicting our hearts, God. And we thank you, Jesus, that you've called us and equipped us to go reach our world for you, Lord. Help us and convict us to dig deeper into your word, to use it as combat against the enemy, just like Jesus did when he was being tempted. And he said, no, you can't tempt the Lord thy God. Help us and use us, God, to reach the world around us, Lord. Give us a hunger and thirst to see souls saved, Jesus. A hunger and a thirst, God. Jesus, we love you so much. We're so thankful for what you're doing and how you're moving in our hearts and in our lives, God. Use us in a mighty way for your kingdom, God. And we thank you, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you that we're alive. We thank you that we're here. We thank you that you died on that cross for us, God, that we can have eternal life with you. Woo! Man, we thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Lord, we love you so much. Be with us. We just decree a blessing over every heart, every person, every soul watching this stream right now, God. We thank you, Lord. Just a blessing on their businesses, blessing on their life, God, blessing over their families, God. That you will use us, and we will be the ones, God, to go transform this world. And it starts with us growing spiritually, leaning into the word of God, leaning into your promises, and looking more like you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Faith Family Church, man, we love you so much. Thank you so much for tuning in. And I just know that God's going to use you in a huge way. Keep going. God's got great things for you. Hey, I love you guys. We'll see y'all next week.